Hello friends, good evening to all. We welcome you all to this nephrology lecture series. Today's speaker is Dr. Susina Alexander, ma'am. Ma'am is professor in the Department of Nephrology. I welcome you, ma'am. The topic for today will be approach to patients with nephritic and nephrotic syndrome. And just a few words about ma'am. I had an opportunity to interact with ma'am during the last year's medicine, and there we had a debate on cyclophosphamide versus MMF for patients with SLE and lupus nephritis. And it was such a wonderful experience that we had while working and interacting with ma'am. Areas of interest include immune-mediated renal diseases, renal genetics, and renal regenerative medicine. So quickly, I'll hand over to ma'am. Ma'am, thank you and very much for giving us your precious time and helping in us to develop our skills and knowledge in this area. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Esta, for that kind introduction. Can you allow me to share the screen?
Sure, ma'am. Just a second, ma'am. Actually, the other screen is with the telemedicine, ma'am. I'll just, Hasna, ma'am, are you there? Hasna, ma'am? Ma'am, just give me 1 minute, ma'am. The screen which is shared right now is from telemedicine. I'm just calling them to take it down so that you can start sharing, ma'am. Just a minute, ma'am.
Okay. Hello, friends. Good evening to all of you who are there. So the presentation for today is approach to a patient with nephritic and nephrotic syndrome. I hope I'm audible. If somebody can just raise their hand or put
yes, ma'am.
In the chat. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, sure. Thanks. Right. So I'll try to make it as simple as possible for you to understand. And if you have any doubts, you can write in the chat box and I'll answer it later on in the presentation. Now, before we go on to the approach, I hope everybody has seen the image of a glomerulus. Okay, now, when we are talking about nephritic and nephritic syndrome, it is a glomerular pathology that we are talking of. We are not talking of other parts of the kidney where there can be pathology like the interstitium, the tubules, or the vasculature. So when you're talking of nephritic and nephrotic, you are concentrating on the glomeruli of the kidney. That doesn't mean that other compartments will not have the pathology. Other compartments also can have concomitant pathology, which can affect the prognosis as well as alter the diagnosis of the disease. But the primary pathology is in the glomeruli. Now, in this picture, you can see an enlarged view of the Bowman's capsule, which is a single glomeruli, which contains a glomerular capillaries, the specialized visceral epithelial cells called podocytes, the parietal peritheleal epithelial cells which line the Bowman's capsule, and the endothelial cells and in the arterioles. And another important cell that is not shown here but is present is in the mesangium, which is yellow colored. So this is the enlarged picture of the glomerulus. This is a single loop. They have taken a single loop and enlarged it. So here you can see that the inner part of the glomeruli is lined by the fenestrated endothelium, which is then followed by the glomerular basement membrane, which is shown in green color, and the podocytes, which have foot processes that are tightly interdigitated, and that form the third layer of the glomerular barrier. So there is endothelial cell, there is a glomerular basement membrane, and there are foot processes of the podocytes. Now, if you can see the picture, the glomerular basement membrane is not only along the glomerular capillary loop, it also winds itself, it joins all the capillary loops. So in between two capillary loops, it also covers the mesangium. So in the mesangium, which is a space that is available between the glomerular loops, that's called the mesangium, and there can be specialized mesangial cells, as well as, and the mesangial matrix, which is a matrix that is in between the cells. This is a more magnified view of a normal glomerulus. It is an electron microscope view. Again, it is labeled, so it's easy for you to understand which is what. There is a GBM, which is labeled as GBM, and which spans through the glomerular capillary loop. The foot processes can be seen on the outer part of the GBM, and the endothelial cell can be seen in the inner part of the GBM. This is circulating blood cells, which are seen within the glomerular capillaries. And beyond the foot process is the urinary space. Now, coming to the clinical manifestations of glomerular disease. So there are many ways in which glomerular disease can manifest. So one of the commonest ways in which they can manifest is hematuria with accompany with or without proteinuria. Okay, but what do you mean by hematuria? So hematuria is the presence of RBCs in blood. When do you call it? So there is a difference between RBCs that are found in a glomerular disease and RBCs that are found in a non-glomerular disease. So because the RBCs have to come through the fenestrated endothelium, go through the GBM, and through the foot processes and come into the urinary space, these RBCs get deformed when they travel through that barrier. So most of the glomerular hematuria, most of the RBCs will be dysmorphic. That is, they won't be isomorphic, they will be dysmorphic, or they will be ring-like with vesicular outgrowth, and these are called acanthocytes. Another characteristic feature of glomerular hematuria is a presence of red blood cell cast. Now, when you find red blood cell cast, which is RBCs that is present within, either it is RBCs that adhere to along with a Tam-Horsfall protein and form the cast, or these are RBCs that are present in a usual hyaline or granular cast. So when there is a presence of RBC cast, it is almost pathognomic of glomerulonephritis. Now, clinically, when we say hematuria, it can mean two things. One is microscopic, that is, you detect the RBCs only in a urine analysis. And the second is macroscopic, that is, there is gross hematuria, and the patient comes and complains to you saying that he's passing blood in urine. again, here you have to note that if usually it is not red in color, it is much more like brownish color because of the disintegration of the RBCs and the hemoglobin. So it's usually called high colored urine. And in certain diseases, like infection related glomerulonephritis, you can have the characteristic Coca-Cola colored urine. So I'll just show you a picture of a dysmorphic RBC. So if you can see on the both on the right and the left side, there are arrows that point to a ring shaped RBC with vesicular outpouching, and this is called acanthocyte. Whereas just a deformation of the shape with spikes is called dysmorphic RBCs. Now the next presentation that can happen is a renal function impairment. It can be known, it can also be called as renal insufficiency. So when there is a functional impairment, obviously, how is it reflected? It's reflected by increase in creatinine or decrease in GFR. Now this renal insufficiency can be either acute, that is if the presentation is within days or within a few weeks, or they can be chronic where there is a slow progressive decline in GFR over time, and usually more than 3 months. There is also another presentation of renal insufficiency, which is called rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis, where it is an in-between category between an AKI, and because AKI is usually, it doesn't go over a week. So the dysfunction is acute, usually within 48 hours and maximum up to a week. RPGN, or rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis, is a rapid progression of renal impairment that is seen over few weeks to months. This is a photomicrograph which shows an RBC cast. It's a very unusual finding. Usually not very difficult to see this. If you can see, there is RBCs are all uniformly packed and they all have uniform shapes. And this is pathognomic of glomerulonephritis. Now the other clinical manifestations of glomerular disease involve can be hypertension. So the patient may not present to you with gross hematuria or proteinuria, or in the his only complaint will be hypertension. So you need to have a high index of suspicion and work up for secondary causes of hypertension, especially in patients who are less than 45 years. And one of the most common secondary causes of hypertension is a renal cause. And in the renal cause, apart from renal artery stenosis, the other cause is renal parenchymal pathology, which is one of it is glomerulonephritis. So many patients, especially in a glomerulonephritis called IgA nephropathy, the only presenting complaint will be new onset hypertension or worsening of hypertension. And it might be accelerated hypertension, and many patients even come to us with history of visual dysfunction. That is, their only complaint will be that there was blurring of vision. They went to the doctor. They found that it is malignant hypertension, or there were some disc changes, and diagnosed new onset hypertension and started on blood pressure. So that's the only complaint that patients come with. Especially we see this in a disease called IgA nephropathy. The other presentation, which is usually due to proteinuria, is edema, which can be peripheral or periorbital. When the edema is very severe and generalized and subcutaneous and involves the subcutaneous tissue, it's called anasaka. Another presentation, but not very common, is hypercoagulability. When there is proteinuria, you also lose a lot of anticoagulant proteins, and there is a disbalance between procoagulant proteins and anticoagulant proteins. So one of the most common protein that is lost in urine is antithrombin 3. So because of this, especially in those who have massive proteinuria and severe hypoalbuminemia, they are predisposed to be having this thrombotic events, which could be on any vessel. It could be a deep venous thrombosis, it could be a renal vein thrombosis, or it could be even pulmonary embolism. So apart from the renal specific or kidney specific manifestations, we should also remember that these may not occur in isolation. There are a whole lot of systemic manifestations that can accompany the glomerular diseases. So it is prudent that we ask for these and have a high index of suspicion and take a comprehensive history when we are dealing with a patient with suspected nephritic or nephrotic syndrome. So mainly, if we are to divide the clinical syndromes of glomerular disease, there is a group of isolated hematuria where there's only RBCs in urine and there is no proteinuria, no systemic manifestation, no hypertension. Then there is isolated non-nephrotic proteinuria where the proteinuria is not massive, but it is not accompanied, it may or may not be accompanied by other manifestations like hematuria, hypertension or systemic manifestation. So if it is not accompanied, it's called isolated, otherwise it's just called non-nephrotic proteinuria. Nephrotic syndrome and the rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. Now, how do we evaluate these glomerular presentations? Now, proteinuria. So there are semi-quantitative as well as quantitative methods of assessing proteinuria. The most common semi-quantitative method is the use of urine dipstick. Now, urine dipstick usually detects albumin. So if urine dipstick is positive, it usually refers to a glomerular proteinuria. Now, when urine dips, there can be, when the proteinuria is due to non-albumin related causes. For example, if it is due to light chains, as seen in multiple myeloma or as seen in amyloidosis, you will still have proteinuria, but the dipstick may not detect it. So you will need to assess proteinuria by other methods. Now the gold standard for assessing proteinuria is 24-hour urine collection. Again, here I would like to reiterate that there is, we should always try and send the 24-hour urine collection of both protein and creatinine, because the interpretation of protein depends on adequate creatinine excretion. So if creatinine excretion is within the normal range for men and women, then the interpretation of the proteinuria is much more accurate. And they also give you, like when they measure the 24-hour urine protein and creatinine, they also take an aliquot from the can and take a ratio. So you get both the values. What is the role of random urine protein by creatinine ratio? Now, random is random. So obviously it is subject to a lot of misinterpretation. Because you're taking it on in any part of the day, the creatinine excretion can vary even within an individual. So if there is practical difficulty in collecting 24 urine protein, there might be in some subset of patients who are not ambulant or who may be having other comorbidities, then always stick to a urine protein by urine collection, which a spot collection, which is at a specific time, and we usually prefer the second morning sample. So this will help you to compare, at least within the individual, the different values. But you may not be able to compare inter-individual, because again, it depends a lot on creatinine excretion, whether it is within the normal range or not. Now, when you are evaluating proteinuria, when you are quantifying proteinuria, one of the major syndromes is nephrotic syndrome. So how do you define nephrotic syndrome? So there are mandatory criteria and there are ancillary criteria. Now, in the mandatory criteria, two criteria should be satisfied. One is a 24-hour urine collection, which should be more than 3.5 grams per day. Or if it is a spot urine sample, it should be more than 3. Albumin of less than 3.5 gram per deciliter. The other ancillary criteria are the presence of edema, hyperlipidemia, and lipiduria. Now, lipiduria can be in different forms. It can be fat droplets that get sloughed along with the tubular cells. And these can be in the form of oval fat bodies or fatty casts, or they can be, and these, when there is polarizing light, then they will have a characteristic appearance called Maltese cross. So this is a fatty cast. Again, if you remember the RBC cast, this fatty cast, the cells are of different sizes. Whereas in RBC cast, all the cells were of similar size. And also the rim of the cell is darkened in fatty cast. If you see them under polarized light, they will have a Maltese cross appearance. So when we evaluate and when we find that there is nephrotic syndrome, how do we go about further evaluating it? Now, the etiologies of nephrotic syndrome, or for that matter, any other glomerular disease syndromes, can be divided into primary syndromes or secondary syndromes. So primary syndromes are syndromes that have pathology that are renal limited. Secondary syndromes are syndromes that have a renal manifestation, but they also have a concomitant manifestation in either other organs or it's part of a systemic disease. Now the most common, this is not an exhaustive list. They have just listed the most common pathologies. So when there is nephrotic syndrome, and when we are thinking of primary nephrotic syndrome, then it is minimal change disease, FSGS, membranous, and C3GNs come forward. And there are a lot others like amyloidosis and all, but these are the most common syndromes. Whereas when you think of secondary nephrotic syndrome, these are diabetic nephropathy is the most common. There are infections, there are autoimmune diseases, lupus nephritis, there are malignancies, and there are even drugs like NSAIDs that can cause nephrotic syndrome. So how do we, again, we should remember that even in nephrotic syndrome, I think I forgot to write that, but kidney biopsy is the gold standard for diagnosing the different kinds of nephrotic syndrome. It is very difficult to make a clinical diagnosis of the etiology of nephrotic syndrome, especially primary nephrotic syndrome, just based on the clinical and the lab parameters, and renal biopsy is a gold standard. Now coming to proteinuria without nephrotic syndrome. Again, by definition, this is a proteinuria more than 300 grams or less than 3.5 grams per 24 hours. And similarly, a random UPCR, which is more than 0.3 and less than 3. Now, proteinuria without nephrotic syndrome can be either isolated. By isolated, we mean there is no other systemic or renal manifestation. So there's absence of systemic disease, hypertension, hematuria, or renal insufficiency. Now, when such a scenario happens, we should always rule out, we should always find out whether it is a persistent proteinuria or not. So if it is not persistent, then that is, if it is not present in repeated collections, then it is a transient proteinuria, which is very benign and can happen with many conditions like fever, exercise, stress. And it's a very benign and you need not work up further. The other kind of proteinuria that is also benign is orthostatic proteinuria. It is usually seen in people who are less than 30 years of age. Again, here, the proteinuria happens only when they are in the upright posture. So how do we diagnose this? So for this, we will need a split urine collection. We will need a daytime urine and we will need a nighttime urine. Now, if there is no proteinuria in the nighttime urine sample, then it points to an orthostatic proteinuria, which is also a benign condition and doesn't require any further evaluation. If it is persistent proteinuria, especially if it is more than 500 milligram per day, but isolated, that is, there is no other, like no hematuria or renal insufficiency, always look for other causes, non-glomerular causes. So it could be because it could be tubular proteinuria. It need not be glomerular, because glomerular proteinuria is usually associated with some form of RBCs, but need not be always the case. It's not mandatory. So always look for non-invasive ways to diagnose. Kidney biopsy is an invasive diagnosis. So invasive diagnosis is always reserved for the last. So tubular pathologies like reflex, structural lesions, all these things can be ruled out first. And if you need a definitive diagnosis after ruling out all this, then definitely kidney biopsy is a gold standard. Again, if you can see the examples given here for etiologies overlap with the examples that I gave for the previous one, which is nephrotic syndrome. So that is why it is very difficult to make an etiological diagnosis just based on the clinical presentation. You can probably narrow it down to three or four diseases, but again, you may find something else when you biopsy. So that is why kidney biopsy is an important investigation. Now coming to proteinuria that is not isolated, which means that there is presence of other symptoms. Here definitely, again, kidney biopsy is a gold standard. As we classified nephrotic syndrome, this can also be classified as primary and secondary, and there is significant overlap of etiopathogenesis. Now, when we come to nephritic syndrome, what do you understand by nephritic syndrome? So in nephritic syndrome, the primary symptom is hematuria. So hematuria accompanied with proteinuria, renal insufficiency, or other manifestations like hypertension. Here, the main pathology is glomerular inflammation. So the cells, so there are, it can be endothelial cells, it can be mesangial cells, it can be epithelial cells, the cells are, or it can be even other cells that come to the kidneys, so circulating leukocytes. They are involved, there can be hyperplasia or proliferation, and there is inflammation. Again, this can present as a chronic progressive rise or as a rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. Now, always look for clinical patterns that can give you some clues. In all glomerular diseases, in all glomerular syndromes, some clinical patterns can help you narrow your differential diagnosis. For example, if a patient comes with a mucosal infection, an ongoing mucosal infection, and says that he's having red color in urine, the most likely diagnosis is IgA nephropathy. But again, I'm saying likely here because it could even be infection-related glomerulonephritis, but the most likely diagnosis here is going to be IgA nephropathy. if a person comes with palpable purpura, again, there is a narrowing of differential diagnosis. So you can think of vasculitis. You can think of ANCA-associated vasculitis, non-ANCA-associated vasculitis, or even Henoch-Schönlein purpura, which is presently renamed as IgA vasculitis. If there's any history of antecedent or ongoing infection, it will point to an infection-related glomerulonephritis. If there is pulmonary renal syndrome, again, it helps you to narrow the differentials. As always, kidney biopsy is the gold standard for diagnosis of glomerular disease. Lot of other ancillary tests that you can do, because kidney biopsy is not a clinical diagnosis, right? It will just give you a histopathology. So after the histopathology has to be correlated with the clinical diagnosis to make the full picture clear. Many of the glomerular diseases, the histopathology itself will clinch the diagnosis. But in other glomerular diseases, it might just tell you the pattern of histopathology. It may not tell you the actual etiology, for which you will need ancillary tests. So most of the common ancillary tests that we did, a whole lot of serological tests. We can also look for blood-borne viruses. If we have to rule out monoclonal gammopathies, then you do serum-free light chains, serum immunofixation, and blood cultures if you're suspecting sepsis or infection-related GM or serologies. Now, probably the only case where you may not perform a kidney biopsy is in isolated glomerular hematuria. That is, you have only microscopic hematuria or gross hematuria, but there is no proteinuria, there is no hypertension, and there is no systemic diseases. So again, here, always rule out other causes in the causes of non-glomerular hematuria or systemic diseases like sickle cell before attributing it to a glomerular disease. Most of the glomerular disease that present with isolated glomerular hematuria are usually benign, and the three likely diagnoses in this case is an early IgA nephropathy where you're not able to pick up the immune deposits, an Alport syndrome, which is a syndrome which affects the basement membrane, and thin basement membrane nephropathy. Again, here I would not say they are fully benign, because there have been long-term follow-up of patients where these a sub-cohort of these patients have progressed. So they will definitely require follow-up even if kidney biopsy is not performed. Now coming to a histopathology, because kidney biopsy is so important in the diagnosis of glomerular diseases, I will take you through the different histopathology techniques that we do, and it will give you an idea of the complexities that are involved in the diagnosis of glomerular diseases and the precautions that we need to take. So histopathology, the first technique is light microscopy. Again, light microscopy, there are different stainings that can be used based on the clinical scenario, but the most hematoxylin, PAS, are used universally. Periodic acid shift helps in evaluating the matrix and the cellularity. We also use stains like methanamine silver, which will help in staining the glomerular basement membrane and the matrix black. Mason's trichrome is also used by renal pathologists if they have to distinguish between scarring and immune deposits. Now, there are certain terms which you need to know. There are many more terms, but at least some common terms which will help you to understand the histopathological pattern in light microscopy. So when somebody is saying there's a focal glomerular pathology, it means, you need to distinguish focal versus diffuse. So when it is focal, it means that out of all the glomeruli, so if there are 10 glomeruli in a sample, in a hyperphene, if there is less than 10 glomeruli, which is abnormal, that is 4, less than 50%, that is 4, anything more than 5 will be diffuse, and less than 5 will be focal. Segmental versus global refers to the pathology within each glomerulus. So if there is at even one among the 10 glomerulus, if there is even one glomeruli which has a pathology which is restricted to one part of its tuft, which is less than 50% of the entire tuft, it is called segmental. Otherwise, if it is a diffuse process, if it is a process which involves the entire glomerular tuft, more than 50%, then it's called global. Proliferative, when you see the term proliferative, it means hypercellularity of the cells. Exudative means it is not just the hypercellularity of the resident cells, but infiltration with circulating leukocytes. There can also be sclerosis and scarring. There can be matrix expansion. Crescents specifically refer to inflammatory collections of cells in the Bowman spaces. It could be mostly it is proliferation of parietal epithelial cells, but it could be visceral epithelial cells also. As I said before, glomerular pathology does not happen in isolation. It happens, there can be concomitant abnormalities in other compartments of the kidney, especially tubulointerstitial injury and fibrosis, which can help you prognosticate the severity of the glomerular disease. So now I'll just take you through a few pictures of light microscopy for you to understand what those terms are. This is a normal glomerulus. So this actually highlights to you why we need all these techniques in renal biopsy. So if you were to do only a light microscopy in a patient suspected with minimal change disease, you will not find any abnormality. The glomeruli will look normal to you. If you do immunofluorescence, again the glomeruli, again it will not pick up any immune complexes. So there comes the technique of electron microscopy. So all these scenarios will tell you the complexities that are involved in the diagnosis of glomerular diseases. Now this is a slide which shows segmental sclerosis. As I said, segmental means the entire glomerular tuft is not involved. Less than 50% of the glomerular tuft is sclerosed. So this is called segmental sclerosis, and if it involves less than 50% of all the glomeruli in the sample, then it's called focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. Again, this is a pattern of injury. This is not an etiology. You have to remember that FSGS is a pattern of injury. It is not a diagnosis. So in FSGS, if the FSGS is accompanied by nephrotic syndrome, or if there are no indications of secondary glomerulonephritis, there are a lot of secondary systemic diseases or like obesity, hyperfiltration injury, hypoxia, all these things can also cause a focal segmental glomerulosclerosis pattern. So if it is a nephrotic syndrome with no other factors suggestive of a secondary FSGS, then it becomes a primary FSGS. And the treatment of primary FSGS is with immunosuppression, whereas secondary FSGS is usually usually reflects a long-standing glomerular injury, and that is managed by supportive medications, by renin-angiotensin system blockers, and not by immunotherapy. Now this is another slide which shows you mesangial hypercellularity. So here, if you look closely, in between the capillary loops, you have this mesangial matrix, which is a little bright red in color. So usually in one mesangial area, you should not have more than 3 mesangial cells. So if you have more than 3 mesangial cells in one mesangial area, that denotes that there is mesangial hypercellularity. Again, mesangial hypercellularity is a pattern of injury. It is not a diagnosis. So it can happen in many diseases. The most common disease where it can happen is a condition called IgA nephropathy, where IgA immunoglobulin, defective IgA immunoglobulins are deposited within the mesangium of the kidney. And this IgA is picked up by immunofluorescence. So that's how you connect the diagnosis. Here, if you see, this is diffuse endocapillary hypercellularity. So here, apart from the mesangial, if you can look at the capillary loops, if you look closely at the capillary loops, most of the capillary loops are closed. There are a lot of leukocytes within the capillary. You can see one neutrophil here, you can see one neutrophil here. The capillary loops appear closed. They are not open and they are closed. There are many neutrophils within the capillary loops, and there is proliferation of the endothelial cells as well as mesangial cells. One common scenario where this can happen is post-streptococcal or infection-related glomerulonephritis. So the term now is not post-streptococcal, because presently we have it shown that any infection, there are many infections that can cause glomerulonephritis. And glomerulonephritis need not be happening after the infection. It can even happen concurrent to the infection. For that matter, we have a good series of our experience that is coming up in an article, and I think it will come out in print. It is already there. If you go to the CJASN website, it's a CJASN, it's a clinical journal of the American Society of Nephrology. Then you can see the article that's come out recently on our experience in infection-related glomerulonephritis, and it's the largest series. So it's good for, especially for physicians, to read that article, because it gives you a view of the different kind of presentations and what are the risk factors and all involved. So I would urge you to go and read that article. Right, so this is a PAA stain where you are actually trying to distinguish what is sclerosis and what is necrosis. So the bright red area are the necrotic areas. Again, it is segmental in nature. That's why it's called segmental necrosis. Now, necrosis is a very severe histopathological lesion. And necrosis is usually seen in rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. And one of the causes of rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis is vasculitis, or it could even be diseases like anti-GBM disease. So this is a case of renal vasculitis, whereas necrosis, and the presentation will most likely be a rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. The another lesion that is of a very severe histopathological nature is something called crescent. So if you see here, this is the entire glomerulus, and the Bowman space is completely occluded with proliferating cells. So, and it is in the form of a crescent. So if you see, it's in the form of a crescent, and the proliferating cells are the parietal epithelial cells that have proliferated and that have formed a crescent shaped occlusion in the Bowman space. This also is a very severe histopathological lesion. It happens usually in the clinical syndrome is like a rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. And the differential diagnosis is usually a vasculitis or an anti-GBM, but it can be others like IgA, or it can be infection-related glomerulonephritis, anything that presents like a rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. Now, immunofluorescence. So to detect immune deposits, there are two ways to detect immune deposits by histopathology. One is immunofluorescence, and the other one is immunoperoxidase microscopy. Now, in immunofluorescence, you look for immuno, the usually there is one panel which is usually done for all biopsies, which will include immunoglobulins, the three immunoglobulins. It will include C3 and C4 and C1q to cover both the classical and the alternate pathway. Fibrin is stained when there is suspicion of vascular syndromes like HUS, TTP, antiphospholipid syndrome. So in these cases, fibrin staining will be useful. Immune deposits can happen either along glomerular capillary loops or in the mesangium, and it could give the pattern of the staining can give a clue to the underlying diagnosis. For example, if it is IgG, which is staining, and it is linear along the glomerular basement membrane, then the clue to the, it is usually due to anti-GBM disease. But if the same IgG is staining the capillary loops, but in a granular pattern, then it is the diagnosis here will be membranous nephropathy. There are many other stains that have come up in clinical practice and can be used based on the clinical scenario. And this will definitely require a specialist feedback and a specialist opinion, because it's an ever expanding list and we keep on discovering new stains that will help you diagnose diseases. Some of them are already, many of them are already available in our pathology department, but some of them are still in the translational clinical research stage. Now, going through a few photomicrographs, this is what I said as a linear staining. There's a very homogeneous uptake along the capillary loops, linear uptake, which is characteristic of anti-GBM disease, linear uptake of IgG. But if it was a linear uptake of, if you say fibrin, so fibrin, if we were to stain for fibrin, and if it was a linear uptake of fibrin along the capillary loops, then that is actually seen in diabetic nephropathy. Okay. Now, this is the difference between granular uptake and linear uptake. Now, you can appreciate the granular uptake here. This is not linear as seen in the previous slide, but it is around the capillary loops. And this is characteristic of membranous nephropathy. Now, if it is more coarser in nature, along the capillary loops, it can indicate an underlying membranoproliferative pattern. Again, the etiologies for this is just a pattern. There are different etiologies for this. IgA typically has a mesangial pattern of uptake of IgA. If you can see, the capillary loops are not getting lightened up here. It's only the mesangial areas which are getting lightened up when they are stained for IgA. Okay, now what is the role of electron microscopy? Now, electron microscopy is almost becoming indispensable for nephrologists for diagnosis. Okay, so there are lots of clues that you get in electron microscopy that may be missed in the regular light microscopy and IF. So, as a common theme, most centers try and do as many electron microscope as possible. Only thing is, it is an expensive test, so not everybody will be able to afford it. But we try and do it for whichever case needs that. We try and even give do it on a concessional basis, because it helps us narrow down the diagnosis in such cases. So it is valuable in defining the morphology of basement membranes. It helps us in identifying the different kinds of fibrils in diseases like amyloidosis or cryoglobulinemia or fibrillar GN or these kind of diseases. Or even it picks up reticular intracellular structures. So certain diseases like lupus nephritis or HIV, the presence of tubular reticular inclusions can give us a clue. The electron microscopy also helps us in localizing the site of immune deposits. Because it is such a magnified view, it can tell us whether the immune deposits are in the mesangium, whether they are in the subendothelium, whether they are in the subepithelial location. Again, it helps us in defining the pattern as whether it is continuous or discontinuous. A few pictures in this respect. This is a normal glomerulus where you can see this is the endothelial cell, the capillary loop, the GBM, and this is covered by the food process, which is intact in this glomerulus. Whereas if you see here, it's a much more magnified view where this is the glomerular basement membrane and this is the endothelial side. So here you have the endothelium. And here, if you look at the food process, it's all effaced. It's no more of the structure that you saw in the previous slide. It's all flattened out. There are no, there are a lot of spaces in between. So this is the food process effacement. Now this is, if the food process effacement is diffuse through the glomerular capillary loop, then it clinches the diagnosis, especially in minimal change disease and it primary FSGS, where this is a characteristic finding. So then, so this lets you know that why EM is so important. There are certain diseases which are due to abnormalities in the glomerular basement membrane. Now, even that, it's very difficult for a light microscopy or an IEF to pick up this finding. Whereas in the EM, you can see that there is a lot of thickening of the GBM, splitting of the GBM, and this is characteristically seen in hereditary nephritis or Alport's syndrome. Coming to the localization of immune deposits, again, this is a glomerular basement membrane, this is the endothelial side, this is a this is a epithelial side, and you can see the dark immune deposits that are there in the subendothelial location. Whereas in membranous nephropathy, you usually see them in the subepithelial location. Here again, this is the glomerular basement membrane. This is the endothelial side. And these are the food processes. These are the epithelial food processes. And you can see the dark immune deposits between the basement membrane and the epithelial food processes. So that is a subepithelial location, which is characteristic of membranous nephropathy. Whereas in IgA nephropathy, the immune deposits are seen mostly in the mesangium. So this is an in-between location between the capillary loops. It is located in the mesangium. So I hope I have given you a good overview of how to approach nephritic and nephrotic syndrome and the various diagnostic and diagnostic dilemmas and complexities that are involved. Thank you.
Ma'am, thank you very much, ma'am. It was a very informative. We learned a lot of new things. If there are any questions, we wait for a couple of minutes, ma'am. If there are any questions, please unmute yourself and ask. There are no questions posted in the chat box also. I'll just wait for a minute or two. If there are any questions, you're welcome to ask. Ma'am, I have a question. This orthostatic proteinuria, ma'am, the mechanism is like a nutcracker mechanism, with the left renal artery getting compressed in the obstacle. Is that the right mechanism, ma'am?
Or need not be. Some people just have, because of the standing position, upright posture itself can lead to hyperfiltration and proteinuria. They need not be always an anatomical abnormality.
Okay, ma'am. And on the long run, it doesn't have any detrimental effect in the renal function, ma'am, does it have?
Not accompanied by any other abnormalities. You definitely need to follow this up, but usually it's benign. So Nitin has asked a question in the chat box, how to differentiate MPGN versus C3GN. Now, I think that question is a little above the MD level. So just to put it in the right context, MPGN, when you say membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, always remember it is a histopathological pattern. Okay, but when you say C3GN, you are referring to a complement abnormality. So you are different. You are, one is a histopathological pattern, the other one is a complement abnormality. So complement abnormality like C3GN can have many histopathological patterns. Okay, MPGN is one of the histopathological patterns in C3GN. There are a lot of other patterns that can be there. Okay, so this is a, just to put it in the broad context.
If there are no more questions, we would like to thank you very much, ma'am, for sparing your time and taking this class for us. It was very informative and very helpful, ma'am. We would look forward to many more classes from specialty departments like yours, ma'am. Thank you so much for your inputs, ma'am. Thank you all. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Esther, and thank you all. God bless.
Ma'am, sorry, this one question just popped up.
Yeah.
Ma'am, are you there? Yes, ma'am.
I'm there.
Yes, ma'am. The question is, Dr. Santosh has asked, C3 and C4 complement level cutoff values, and how often is it to be repeated?
No, cutoff values are based on the lab which does it. So each lab will have a standardized way to do it. So in our lab, there is a normal range which they follow for the method that they use. So that usually it is not like an absolute cutoff which can be followed from one center to the other. Okay, so there is a normal range which is dependent on the standardization of that lab and what antibodies they use for detecting C3 and C4. What was the other part of the question?
How often to repeat it, ma'am? I think he means in following up a patient.
Okay, so if it's a C3 or a C4 abnormality, there are different diseases. So some of the diseases that come into my mind, it can be lupus nephritis, or it could be a infection related GN. So generally to see a response in the complement pathway, especially when you're giving immunosuppression or if you're following it up, 6 weeks is a good target to repeat the complements. Okay, so 6 weeks to 2 months, you should be able to see a response. Okay, and then probably once a year, especially if it is a complement dependent pathology, then you repeat it. Otherwise you don't repeat it. So if it is lupus nephritis, then probably if they are in remission, then when they come for the annual review, you can repeat it, because that helps you to detect the early flares in lupus.
Thank you very much, ma'am. There are no more questions. Thank you very much, ma'am.